como un arroyo que desciende dulcemente de una colina. Sobre piedras frescas en la quietud de la noche. Acompañándole el claro de luna y la luz de las estrellas que se bañan en el agua. El blanco sendero bredoso desciende burbujeante, transformándose en un arroyo de leche.
My stroke did not just change my life, it saved my life. So David Talbot begins his memoir, Between Heaven and Hell, The Story of My Stroke. Annie Lamott says the book is touching, informative, sometimes funny, sometimes harrowing. I could not put it down. I felt the same. David Talbot will appear in Berkeley on Wednesday, January 27th at the Hillside Club, 2286 Cedar Street. It's a KPFA benefit, wheelchair accessible. Quincy McCoy, KPFA's terrific manager, will be in conversation with Talbot. Conversation that promises to be tender, powerful, humorous, intimate, uncensored, pals talking. Tickets available online at brownpapertickets.com or at supportive indie bookstores. David Talbot, January 27th.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.
Hey everyone, this is Mitch Jezrich, urging you to become a KPFA ally, a sustaining partner, the lifeblood of our station. At $10 or more a month, your gift goes further by providing KPFA with a stable source of income to support the programming that you value. It's easy and it provides a tax deduction, plus it helps us reduce the amount of time needed on air for fund drives, and I like that a lot. So to become an ally, go to kpfa.org and click support. Thank you.
Do you know what Area 941 is? It's kpfa.org's new podcasting space. This allows us to expand our programming with more on-demand programs so you can listen when you want or download them at any time. Area 941 is just another reason why people say, I heard it on KPFA.
Good evening. The time is 6:05 p.m. Stay tuned for Making Contact. Contact. You'll hear excerpts from the documentary Spies of Mississippi, the real story of government spying on activists during the civil rights era.
Within 3 to 4 years of its being formed, the Mississippi State Sovereign Commission transforms itself into a full-blown spy agency with a whole network of investigators and agents to go around the state exploring things that were going to possibly change what people euphemistically called the Mississippi way of life.
Imagine being black in the 50s. You return home from defending your country to segregated Mississippi, where you are denied admissions to Mississippi Southern College because of the color of your skin. You publish a letter protesting the racist laws of your state, only to be put under surveillance by a state commission that slaps false charges against you and gets you in prison until your last days. That's the story of civil rights activist Clyde Kinnard, who was released just before his death in 1963. He wouldn't be pardoned until 50 years later. The Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission, or SUVCOM, performed this type of state-sanctioned persecution and murder. Although this took place more than 50 years ago, one can draw parallels to the several executive orders and policies that target vulnerable communities today: Muslims, undocumented immigrants, African Americans, and LGBTQ people. Spies of Mississippi, a documentary directed and produced by Don Porter and executive produced by Lux TV and Martina Hallbridge, takes a close look at the Mississippi Sovereignty Commission, an agency established shortly after the Brown versus Board of Education decision, to ensure that the state would remain segregated. SUVCOM coordinated its activities with members of the Ku Klux Klan, a domestic terrorist organization that illegally surveilled the activities of civil rights workers and prevented attempts to desegregate the state and register blacks to vote.
The political atmosphere in Mississippi in the middle 1950s was beginning to change very drastically.
By 1956, Brown versus Board of Education had been passed. The great Supreme Court ruling that said that you couldn't discriminate within education on the basis of race. The legislature of Mississippi was almost 100% segregationist. And many of them rabid segregationists at the time who felt that the struggle was starting to turn against the state and that the federal government was gaining power to enforce civil rights laws. And they create a special agency with the direct mission to preserve segregation.
In the legislature of 1956, one of the major bills that was passed during that session was a bill to create something called the Sovereignty Commission.
I'm sure that you will not fail to enact an appropriate state sovereignty bill, which will enable us during the next 2 years to maintain a successful fight for preserving the separation of the races in this state.
At that time, it seemed to be a harmless kind of legislation. It was more like a white chamber of commerce. Then we began to ask questions about it, about how that bill could be abused. It passed, however, and was enacted by the legislature and signed by Governor Coleman and set in motion.
This is Mississippi, the central state, the heart of the South.
It started out as a public relations campaign with films like Message from Mississippi, letting the world know that people liked the system of segregation in Mississippi and that nothing should ever change it.
Out of the statewide pattern of segregation, mutual respect and cooperation among the races, has arisen a productive, law-abiding way of life. Reverend J.W. Jones, colored pastor of New Albany and editor of a statewide colored newspaper, has this to say.
We have far less crime in our race in Mississippi in proportion to the population than in any state in the nation. I believe this is because of the way of life in Mississippi.
They sent out mailings. They sent out speakers. They invited newspaper people into the state, talked to them, tried to persuade them that, you know, all is well here. We got some good black people, and we treat them well.
The Sovereignty Commission became an instrument of state power in enforcing segregation.
It's initially a small agency under the control of the governor that will keep track of these civil rights organizations.
We were mounting what I think of as an earned insurgency in this country and in Mississippi. I think that earned for us the right to go to the rest of the country and say, we need the rest of the country to take a look at what's going on in Mississippi.
If you registered to vote, you immediately became an enemy of the state. If you rented from a white person, you were kicked out. If you worked for a white person, you were fired. And yet we got thousands of people to take on an entire state that was committed to an apartheid system that would make South Africa blush.
It was the beginning of the so-called civil rights era. That's when the tensions began to rise over what was coming, what people thought was coming down the road.
Within 3 to 4 years of its being formed, the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission transforms itself into a full-blown spy agency with a whole network of investigators and agents to go around the state exploring things that were going to possibly change what people euphemistically called the Mississippi way of life.
The Sovereignty Commission spy program actually started at a very small level. It's a couple of agents, usually former state police investigators, even former FBI agents, who are highly skilled investigators, and they're at the core. I'll never forget finding the file on Clyde Kennard, the young man whose great crime against the state of Mississippi was to apply to go to college.
Clyde Kennard was a Korean War veteran, an upstanding citizen who had studied in northern universities and who was very ambitious and a profoundly decent and good guy. In the 50s, Clyde Kennard tried to go to the University of Southern Mississippi.
In the 1950s, the few African Americans in the South who were able to enroll in college could only attend black schools. Kennard's application to attend Mississippi Southern was seen as an attack on segregation and set into motion a swift response from the state. His application was given to the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission, an organization few Mississippians even knew existed.
They did a report that tracked his background growing up in Mississippi, his time spent with his family in Chicago, his time in the military, his time at the University of Chicago, and his time back in Mississippi helping his ailing mother on her chicken farm. With multiple agents tracking everybody in his background, they couldn't come up with anything that could undercut his application to go to college.
The police, with the cooperation of the State Sovereignty Commission, planted stolen chicken feed from the county co-op. About 20 bucks worth of chicken feed planted on his farm. He didn't steal them. Everybody knows that. But he was arrested for that and he was put in prison for 7 years.
He was sentenced to Parchment Penitentiary, the worst prison at that time probably in the country. They let him out a couple months before he died of cancer, but only because he was terminal.
That Sovereignty Commission did all they could to hold back progress in our state and basically discourage any kind of efforts to bring black and white people together.
There were rumors that the white car parked outside the gate of Tougaloo College was taking down the license plate numbers of everyone, black or white, who went to an interracial meeting. It turns out that is what was happening. People would then be afraid to come to another meeting.
One of the things that they were really known for doing was getting the license plate tags, names, and addresses of people who were attending civil rights meetings and giving them to newspaper editors who would publish the names and addresses of these people, which is an incredibly effective terror tactic because they obviously were subject to night raids by the Klan or by other terrorist groups or by individuals who were just bent on white supremacy.
So other black leaders knew that there was something going on, that these white agents who were showing up at their meetings, taking down their license numbers, were part of something, but they didn't know it was the Sovereignty Commission.
The future of the United States of America may well be determined here in Mississippi. For it is here that democracy faces its most serious challenge. Can we have government in Mississippi which represents all of the people? This is a question which must be answered in the affirmative if these United States are to continue to give moral leadership to the free world.
There is no case in history where the Caucasian race has survived social integration. We will not drink from the cup of genocide.
And just over the period of a little over 2 weeks, you had 50 major demonstrations across the country in all parts of the United States, not being created by the federal government, they're being created by people who are dissatisfied with being treated as second-class citizens. And this is the difficulty. We have to do something about it. We have to deal with it.
By 1960 in the Deep South, the sit-in movement has just exploded. The Sovereignty Commission sees this happening in this rapid development and growth of an organized civil rights movement where you do have people who call themselves civil rights activists. And so the Sovereignty Commission has to ramp up its own efforts to defy the civil rights movement and these activists.
The State Sovereignty Commission really assumed its mature and most malignant form after 1960, after Ross Barnett was governor of the state. The agency really became sort of the Stasi of Mississippi under Ross Barnett.
They double the number of spies they have themselves. They decide they're going to try and reach out. Well, how can we do this? These detective agencies kind of volunteer their services.
These private detective agencies had both white investigators and black investigators.
They had four or five detective agencies that they hired to help do the work of the Sovereignty Commission to investigate these people, to attend civil rights meetings.
So the black detective became the new model, and they could keep the payments to the detective agencies hidden, and certainly the role of the black detective would be very difficult for anyone to trace.
Spies, let us know what these marches were going to do, where they were going, what towns they were going to. The Sovereignty Commission was trying to keep up with the invasion from the north. The marches coming down through here, you know, and we pretty well did.
There's 160,000 pages of spy reports talking about tracking Medgar Evers, talking about preparing for an arrival of Martin Luther King into the state of Mississippi, getting information in advance about what his route would be and what the strategy would be to undercut him.
In many cases, as it pertains to specific civil rights events or organizations, how little the Sovereignty Commission actually knew compared to what it thought it knew. And oftentimes that was because of the ability of civil rights activists to funnel the information that they wanted to funnel back to the Sovereignty Commission through these people who they knew were black informants.
The Sovereignty Commission saw itself as working within the boundaries of state government, knowing that the mission of state government was to preserve segregation and was rooted in white supremacy. So the Sovereignty Commission was supplying information to the police agencies, the state police, the county sheriffs, without fully realizing that the Ku Klux Klan was on the ascendancy and that its strategy was to infiltrate the county sheriff's departments.
The Klan had more or less disappeared in the 1920s and hadn't been much through the 30s and 40s and 50s, but it came back with a vengeance, of course, in the 1960s and thoroughly terrorized the state with its campaign of bombing.
But is it violence when our communities are jeopardized by such sex-crazed, idiotic mobs as the Deacons or the NAACP? I say, ladies and gentlemen, we've got to make our stand. And I say that it is not violence when we protect ourselves.
The Sovereignty Commission, like the Klan, viewed Freedom Summer as an invasion. I mean, they basically thought, we're under siege, this is war.
The training in Ohio that we were doing for the young people that was coming for the 1964 Summer Project lasts for 2 weeks. The training had to do with preparing them for coming into Mississippi. Those three things you needed to be prepared for was to be beaten, to be put in jail, and to be killed. And if you're not prepared for all three of those, we won't hold it against you if you decide not to come.
So when the Sovereignty Commission comes over and begins spying on Mickey Schwerner back in spring of 64, they're sharing that information with the Meridian Police Department. Well, the Meridian Police Department, according to, I've talked directly to the officers themselves, more than half the police force over there were probably Klansmen.
Cheney, Goodman, and Swerner went to investigate the burning of a church, firebombing of a church.
So the Sovereignty Commission was clearly responsible for funneling information about the whereabouts of Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney that day that they were investigating the church burning to local officials in Neshoba County in Philadelphia, Mississippi. Those local officials, the sheriff's office in particular, would arrest Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney that day, take them to the jail, where that night they would be taken out of the jail and would disappear. And for the next several weeks, there was a massive manhunt looking for these disappeared civil rights activists.
You're listening to Spies of Mississippi on Making Contact. Directed and produced by Don Porter and executive produced by Lux TV and Martina Hallbridge. To watch the full film or find out more about the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission, check out our website at radioproject.org. Sign up for our podcast or follow us on Twitter. Our handle is making_contact. Now back to the film, Spies of Mississippi.
We know that three young men disappeared some time ago. And we know what happened to civil rights workers. We know what happened to Negroes in Mississippi when they disappear. Sometimes you find them in the river. Sometimes you find them hanging from trees. And sometimes you don't find them.
I have no reason to believe that these people have been killed. And we don't have any information with the state police that would justify any such conjecture.
So you have the governor of Mississippi, Senator Eastland, they're all coming out publicly and saying, oh, this is a hoax. They're probably down there with Castro smoking cigars and Cuba and, you know, all this kind of talk. The time that Governor Johnson said that, he said that in Neshoba County. And where he was standing when he claimed it was a hoax, he was standing literally like less than a few miles from where the bodies were buried. 44 days later, the FBI gets tipped off and they do find where the bodies are buried and they do dig up the bodies.
There was a map that can be found in the Sovereignty Commission files today that indicates the direct location of the bodies. It's a hand-drawn map that shows them buried underneath this earthen dam. It is clearly more information that indicates that, again, the Sovereignty Commission knew exactly what had happened, knew where these guys were, and knew that they were dead long before this several-week, multi-month search for their bodies had concluded.
When those bodies were dug up, then suddenly there was no hiding place anymore. There was no hiding place for the Klan anymore. You know, the FBI was getting involved in the case. They were already involved in the case, but they were going to pursue the case. This one was not going to be ignored.
This country could not really reconcile. Why do three young people get killed for trying to register black people to vote, even in Mississippi?
When Agent X was working out of Canton, Mississippi, he reported the license plate off the station wagon that the three civil rights workers were later driving.
While the identity of Agent X was never officially revealed, a number of activists went through those files and asked the question, who was at these meetings that were compromised? Who was there when we were talking about these things that ended up in a file of the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission? And through a process of connecting the dots, it all led to one man, R. L. Bolden.
They claimed that I was a spy. That was a lie. I wasn't no spy. I was worse than shocked. I didn't realize that kind of information was out there because it wasn't true. It's possible that the detective agency was passing on information.
I knew R.L. very well. He was the vice president of the state NAACP, and he was intimately involved with us, and we didn't have any signs or indication that he was to the contrary. It was only through the diligence of late Senator Henry Kirksey who began to pinpoint things to determine that he was working with the State Sovereignty Commission. And that had to do with him digging off into the files and looking at reports and seeing reports